Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Bruce Pickering, Executive Director of the Asia Society Northern California Center, and your moderator for tonight's program. Tonight's program is being held in association with the Commonwealth Club's Asia Pacific Forum. In the aftermath of the Japanese earthquake and tsunami on March 11th of this year, more than 27,000 people are known to be dead. Over 135,000 are homeless, and property damage is estimated over $309 billion. The Japanese government has also confirmed that three nuclear reactors experienced a meltdown following the natural disasters, with the extent of contamination yet to be determined. To give us an update on the current situation and to address the actions of the Japanese government as well as the lessons that have been learned from this, I'm pleased to introduce today's distinguished speaker, Hiroshi Inomata, Consul General of Japan in San Francisco. Consul General has only been here about a little less than a year, but he's a 34-year veteran of the Japanese Foreign Service, following his graduation from Waseda University's International Law Faculty. He's served in a variety of hardship posts, including Bangkok, London, and Seoul. And here in San Francisco, I can tell you that he's actually had...
In Washington, D.C.
That would be a hardship post. So with that in mind, I think I'm going to turn the program now over to Consul General Hiroshi Inomata, Consul General of Japan in San Francisco.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for a kind introduction, Bruce. Always you're kind enough. I'm very much pleased to be here, even honored to be here at this very much prestigious club, Commonwealth Club. And I'm really thankful to Commonwealth Club to give me a precious opportunity to speak about Japan's experienced challenges and aftermath of Great East Japan earthquake. But let me start by expressing my sincere condolences and sympathy to all the victims of a natural disaster this year. Late February, we did have an earthquake in Christchurch in New Zealand, and one after that, one in China, and March 11. And here in the United States, we have a large scale of tornado and floods and wildfires. If we turn to look at African continent, relatively large and long drought and then spreading around East African continent. Again, I really would like to express my sincere condolences and sympathy to those. Well, it works. March 11th, 2:46 p.m. Japan time, a massive earthquake with a magnitude of 9.0 struck northeast part, yes, of Japan. And the largest earthquake in the recorded history of Japan, and then the fourth largest in the world ever since the start of the 20th century. Around 10:50, March 10 in California time, I had a call that there was an earthquake. And I switched on the TV, and the scene I saw was rather unbelievable. And it was quite shocking to see gigantic tsunami swept across many cities and then village. Okay. Across the Pacific coast of the Tohoku district, causing tremendous human and structure damage. Well, Japan suffered from three simultaneous disasters: earthquake, tsunami, and nuclear accident. Nuclear power plant station is near to the actual place where the earthquake hit. But distance-wise, I think it's like from San Francisco to Tokyo to that nuclear power station's area is San Francisco Reno in Nevada, 142 miles and 144 miles. Since California had hit three big earthquakes in the past, 1906 and 1989 in both in San Francisco and 1994 in Northridge in Los Angeles. So there are some commonality between Japan and California. And by the way, the latitude of northeast this part is almost the same as the latitude of the Bay Area in California. So that I think we have many, we have learned lessons, and also that can be shared with California. And June 22nd, actually there was, in Sacramento, we had California-Japan Business Recovery Forum, where the California state government and Japanese and American business communities and the Consul General of Japan in San Francisco attended. We shared the information, and then we share the ideas what we can make better place in the future. And also June 29th in Palo Alto, and three Silicon Valley business organizations, Japanese and Chinese and Indians, get together and held a forum to discuss what Silicon Valley can do to help rebuild Japan. I think I very much appreciate that happens, and we did have a really good discussions discussing on how we can fully utilize IT technology. Because at the time of earthquake, I tried to reach my my family in Tokyo, but the telephone line is cut so that I cannot easily to get in touch with my daughter. But since using Skype or internet, we can communicate each other. So that's, I really appreciate it. And also, there are many incoming calls to our Consul General Office a few days after this incident, asking whereabout the people who they know in those areas affected. Then Google's Person Finder, that service is quite helpful to us. Well, the tsunami washed some areas away and then left ton of debris. But a few days after the scene itself, there are many, many debris, but 3 months later, it has almost cleaned up. And also a highway in Ishinomaki, that's one city in Miyagi Prefecture, the earthquake and then the tsunami actually put certain part of the road, highway, under the water. But 3 months later, it now becoming a normal sort of road, much improvement. Sorry. So now look at the damages which caused by these two, a tsunami and then an earthquake. Beside the loss of over 15,000 precious lives, the damages have been extensive and tremendous. Estimates of direct damage to facilities and infrastructure, 16 to 25 trillion yen, that's equal amount like 200 US billion to 300 US billion. That is the facility and the infrastructure, so direct damage. But adverse impact to the Japanese economy is limited, since the Pacific Ocean coast, which suffered the most, accounts only for 2.5% of total Japanese economy. So in that context, it doesn't have much impact on Japanese economy itself. And also, I just would like to mention that we have much more sort of improvement and recovery. This expressway and then airport. Actually, expressway, and we call Tohoku Expressway. This is the 220 miles out of 120 miles expressway, more than half has been damaged on the earthquake itself. But the traffic restriction was lifted on March 24th, just in 2 weeks' time. And at the Sendai Airport, it has been quite badly damaged by the tsunami. Surprisingly rapid progress, thanks to the cooperation between U.S. forces in Japan, including Marine Corps, and then Japan Self-Defense Forces, to clean up the debris, and then the entire highway was restored and became usable by March 28th. And that's in less than 3 weeks' time. An actual flight from Haneda to Sendai resumed operation on April 13th, a month after the earthquake. However, there was large damage to agriculture and fisheries, the region being a relatively big supplier of the agricultural and marine products to metropolitan Tokyo area. The total share of the Iwate, Miyagi, and Fukushima, these three prefectures, add up to 9.8% of national fishery products, and then 8% of national agricultural products. So that damaged nearly $13 billion in fisheries and $9.3 billion in agriculture has been counted. I just like to mention one thing is that on agriculture front, Nissei Farmers Association, the headquarters in Fresno in California, they set up farmer-to-farmer assistance line, so that they are very much working on this, and I very much appreciate that. And damage to the nuclear power stations, energy supply and policies. The nuclear power station trouble has been serious. First, radioactive contamination issues, and then secondly, affecting power supply to the metropolitan Tokyo area. And policy on overall nuclear power, as well as overall energy policies. But I will come back on this nuclear issue later. So I'll move on to the third. In a way, the nuclear power station trouble also caused serious damages to the country's safe image. Part of it is a misperception about the radiation level. Sometimes there are exaggerated media reports on radioactivities. So international shipping and distribution has been subject to strict inspections, which impedes the smooth exchange of goods, obviously, and also a big impact on the tourism. Actually quite a huge decrease in the number of the tourists to Japan. March 11th onward, altogether whole March is 50.3% down compared with the one year before. But April, 62.5% down. As you may know, the latter part of March and early part of April is quite a good season to visit Japan because of the cherry blossom is in full bloom. So this is a really great deduction of the number. But May, 50.4% down, so that a sign of slight recovery in May we can see. And also we did have a problem with supply chain issue, but more than 90% of return to the production in the factories, so that supply chain matters seems to become better now. And however, okay, this one is up. And Japan was not totally unprepared when the disaster hit. We developed advanced technologies and regulations based on past experiences. And the good news is that some of these efforts paid off. Recent advancement of IT is helping the system a lot, as I mentioned. And then earthquake early warning technology senses P-wave and notifies the public of earthquakes and buys time to saved lives before S-waves arrive. And the tsunami warning system is so designed that the warning be issued within 3 minutes after an earthquake hit Japan. Well, we may need to utilize more sort of advanced IT technology or services like cloud services. And Japan has developed strong building codes for earthquake resistance based on past experience as well. The most structures proved amazingly quake resistant, even with the 9.0 magnitude. Well, we did have a number of casualties, quite a lot, but most of them are from maybe tsunami and not the earthquake. It is said to be the number of the casualties from the earthquake was actually quite low. And one more things I would like to mention is that Japan's high-speed rail system caused no casualties and survived entirely intact. All 27 trains operating in area slowed automatically and stopped safely as designed, and there was not a single derailment. I think this is a good news for California, I hope, because California is thinking about introducing high-speed rail. Japan is one of the contenders. Now, nuclear problem. Well, at the time of the earthquake and tsunami hit, the affected area, there are 4 nuclear power stations and with 14 units. Well, out of 14, 3 were under periodical inspections. Because of the earthquake, the operating 11 stations shut down automatically. That worked. But cooling down system, 4 out of 14, got certain damaged. Because earthquake, off-site power has been lost. So that shut down directly. But because of the tsunami, although we did have 18 feet high breakwater above sea level, and then also the facilities, station itself is above 10 meters high than sea level, that is 34 feet high. But because of the height of the water level of tsunami was recorded as 30 feet. And then the run-up height, because the tsunami hit the coast, so it's going to run up. This was 130 feet, the largest ever recorded in Japan, though. So these water coming in, so that direct diesel generator became inoperable. So that caused the failure of this facility. And now, so that because of accident, the 20 kilometers radius of the plant and designated area, that is no entry. And so that if the cooling system is still working, then there is no need. But because of the tsunami, nuclear power reactors' emergency cooling system stopping working. So that's the reason why we set up this kind of special area. And then the designated area of 30 kilometers radius of the plant, emergency evacuation preparation area. So that people living those areas, totaling amount, I think 80,000, are evacuated and still in evacuated. I don't know when they can come back. Really, they would like to be back as soon as possible, but it may take some time, I'm afraid to say. Let me introduce some scientific findings at this moment. Despite fears, radioactivity in Tokyo is actually quite low, less than some major world cities. These are the, Hong Kong say 0.14 microsievert per hour. In New York, 0.095 microsievert per hour. In Tokyo, it's 0.078 microsievert per hour. So it's smaller than these two other cities, major cities. By the way, microsievert, I never come across with this unit, but even 5 years old Japanese children knows this, what microsievert means these days. Because every day we discuss on how much microsievert we have. For your information, I think a single chest X-ray is 50 microsievert you can get. And then also an air trip between Tokyo and New York, 200 microsievert you can get, expose you to 200 microsievert. And it is said that natural radiation falling on the Earth is on average 2.4 microsieverts. So any government is working to ensure public safety. Central, local government in Japan. Their focus includes safe water, and then food inspection and product quality control and testing. So water, surely drinking water, every day they have some checking, and then the food as well, and inspects radioactivity levels in food every day and restrict the distribution of food if necessary. And the fish, that applies to fish, but fish, in case of fish, it's not every day, but once a week, as I understand. And the products, again, the checking. But thanks to the effort of the Japanese people and international help, much of the economic supply chain has recovered quite quickly. And next one is, next I would like to discuss on the energy policy. We have 54 nuclear reactors in 17 power plants that exist in Japan. But currently, only 19 reactors are in operation because some has been suspended due to the earthquake and also some others' periodical inspection. Before the quake, Japan planned to increase the ratio of electricity for nuclear power by 50. Now 26, try to 50. But because of this, the plan to even establish additional 14 new reactors suspended. And government is now starting to do a so-called stress test, two stages. So that makes maybe less and less nuclear power stations in operation in Japan. So thermal energy combined oil, natural gas, and coal, natural gas, that is nearly 70%, and then nuclear, 30%. If we don't have a nuclear power generations, that's 30%, we have to get some other sources. So now we try to do our best to develop new renewable energy and at the same time save energy. So setsuden in Japanese is buzzword now in Japan again, and then save electricity. So government asks major companies and shopping malls or universities or even private or individual households to reduce electricity consumption by 15%. The factory shifted production schedule for an aggressive nationwide effort to fight the power shortage. Say factories work on weekends, and instead taking Friday, Thursday off to spread out electricity consumption at plants and offices during peak power need period. Say, now, how we can recover and overcome the challenges. Short term, surely we have to clean debris, erecting temporary housing, which we are doing, rehabilitating industrial facilities. And mid and long term, creating disaster resilient local community, eco-friendly social system, and promoting social welfare. 1 month after the earthquake and tsunami, we set the cabinet approved the Reconstruction Design Council in response to the Great East Japan earthquake to discuss the blueprint for the recovery plan. And on June 25th, a report toward reconstruction, Hope Beyond the Disaster, was submitted to the Prime Minister, focusing four areas. A new concept for rebuilding the region, restore life and livelihood, the work toward reconstruction after the nuclear accident, and open reconstructions. Well, these are kind of guidelines, and that is psychological things, but based on this, and then on June 28th, government at headquarters held its first meeting headed by Prime Minister Khan. The reconstruction minister has been also appointed. And they are aiming at the end of July, this month, to complete measures for the recovery. And vigorous discussions are expected to follow, especially in how to fund the recovery plans. Relief for the evacuees and affected, reconstruction of life and local economies in affected areas, impact on Japan's nuclear power safety policy, eventually on overall energy policies, how we meet Japan's goals for renewable energy and energy conservation, injury to Japan's safe image, especially in export and tourism. Well, finally, I think I would like to express my profound gratitude to compassion and friendship from US and international all over the world, especially the United States. As I mentioned, massive support for the United States rescue team, US Armed Forces, nuclear experts, because on this matter, I think Department of Energy, the US Nuclear Regulatory Commission provided a huge quantity of pure water to cool the damaged reactor first. And then unmanned drones and robots to inspect the reactor because this is contaminated radiations. And 10,000 protective suits. That's quite grateful. And Operation Tomodachi, as you have seen in many occasions, USS Ronald Reagan aircraft and other 20 naval vessels, approximately 20,000 military personnel. Very much grateful. And then California and also San Francisco, many words of sympathy and then encouragement and condolences and offer of assistance. Well, I think the time has passed so quickly. And then if you would like to further information, I would like you to visit our website, saf.us.emb/japan.go.jp. Really, I would like, this is our responsibility to regain the cheerful smiles on the faces of the children. On that purpose, we will do our best. And at the same time, we need your help still. And I thank you very much for your assistance. And at the same time, I would like to continue to work with you and share the information with you, because we need to cooperate together to tackle this difficult situation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Consul General. It's now time for the audience question period, and we have quite a number of questions from the audience, and I think I'll start out with the more local and build to the larger picture. So the one comes through is a question about the region, the Tohoku region. Can you give us a little bit more background as to how the region is coping? It was an area that was in some economic distress before the earthquake and tsunami, and how are the people of the region actually coping with the disaster?
Yeah, as you could see through the TV screen, they are very much coping each other because most of them lost their families and they lost houses and everything. And farmers and fishermen, they lost everything. But they try to unite together to cope with these situations. And then I do see that they are sort of cooperative spirit together to work for, to rebuild their community. So I'm very much pleased to see those kind of things. And in the locally, they have very much cooperative. So I'm very much appreciate that.
Prime Minister Khan has been criticized for his lack of leadership at that point in time. What do you think he could have done better? And here's a hard ball. Do you think he should resign?
Well, it's not your question, though, I hope. I think you are my friend, Bruce. But, it's not coming
friend.
From you, maybe. I should be politically correct, you see. Try to avoid the answer directly, but we could have done differently, could be. But critics, it's easy. Criticizing what wrong, it's easy for us to do. At this moment, government is trying to make strenuous effort to handle all the problems. But I do have some reservations to what the present government is doing. But as I said, I should be politically correct here. And then I think I can answer to you after this session is over.
All right. Let me rephrase it potentially in a little less direct. What lasting impacts do you think the earthquake and the tsunami's destruction will have on Japanese politics and on Japanese society?
Let me answer to the first, the society itself. I think people in northeastern part of Japan are very much strong and then caring each other. There's maybe characteristic of the people in northeastern part of Japan. And then we, even Japanese, we are very much moved to see there are sort of corporations, and even they carrying each other at the time of difficulty. So that we revisit our good old tradition to help each other in the community. So that might be the one sort of things which society might have learned this time. As for the politics, even before that, last 5 years, I don't know how many prime ministers we did have, six out of five, or now seven, I think. So that politically, we need really strong leadership to cope with this unprecedented crisis, because we have to overcome this tremendous difficulty. We need a strong leadership. So in that context, politics has been also affected because of this big and tragic and then gigantic tsunami and then devastating natural disaster. That's, I think.
As a corollary to that question, what are some of the ways that the government of Japan has collaborated with local and international NGOs in providing relief to residents in the northern Honshu prefectures?
Well, I think it's underway, though. At the first few weeks, we had a difficulty in coping with even local government, between local government and central government, because of the communication problem. Lifeline has been cut, and laws, or even telephone lines, But now we could have very much intensive communications between local and central government and try to use the NGO or NPO type of people. And we have experienced 1995 in Hanshin Awaji earthquake, you may call Kobe earthquake. At that time, we are not ready to cope with not many NGOs. And in Japan, sort of volunteer work, maybe that is the maybe first time Japanese young people get together to help the people, not necessarily they normally have relations with, but for the benefit of those people who are affected in such kind of big earthquake in Hanshin Awaji. So this is the maybe the birth of Japanese voluntary works. Now, we learned from that time, so that this time of this earthquake and tsunami, I think we have a really good coordination with NGO, NPO, or voluntary groups, activities. But if things go through to the government level, we need some procedures, and then we have to find out the counterpart in the local government. So it may take some time to even handing certain letters of condolences from here to the affected area through government channels. But if you go through directly to the NGO working in those areas, it may be easier to get. So that kind of problem you might have still. So that quite many inquiries to the Consul General Office to send paper cranes to the affected areas, but we asking them maybe if they knew the place, people who can handle those things, better to do it directly. That's what we are advising. Although I would like to do it by myself, but there are certain limitations. If government does, as I said, there are certain procedures, things to do.
Well, as you can imagine, quite a few of the questions that came from the audience asked what lessons California should take to heart from the earthquake and the tsunami. You know, as everybody knows, the state of California has many of the same issues with respect to the natural environment that Japan has, especially with earthquakes. And so one of the questions that's emerged many times is, as now a resident of the Bay Area, is what do you think we should be doing differently, and what lessons can we draw in California from Japan's recent experience?
Well, firstly, as I said, the early warning system, this is quite workable, because we cannot stop the earthquake happens, because this is nature that's decide. So that all we need is just preparedness for the disaster. So that early warning system does work, because we are living in a quite advanced IT ages, so that better to utilize IT technology. That's the one thing I think I can tell.
Do you believe that more regulation is needed to control the relationship between Japan's nuclear industry and the Japanese government? This comes out of a series of questions about the future of the Japanese nuclear industry. I've got three or four of them, and this is the first one. But there's quite a lot of people are curious about how in the past, and I'll tell you partly where this comes from is, I was at a discussion with Stuart Brand recently where he made a very strong pitch just before, within a week before the earthquake, where he made the point that nuclear power is really the only way that globally we can meet the pending energy crisis that he sees coming. Of course, I haven't heard anything from him since then. And I think one of the questions is that it was a great idea until the worst case happened with Japan. So the series of questions that I have here are really based on Japan's reaction, both initially, this is a question about the future of the relationship between the Japanese government and the nuclear power industry, and then the next two will have to do with the future beyond that.
You mean the government, relation between government and the nuclear power company?
Yes, and essentially, well, I think the question is...
Sure. Some countries, I mean, like in France, the government always controlling the nuclear power generations. There is the opinions in Japan as well, even among the government. We had better to run the nuclear power generations by the government itself. Still, they are talking on this. I myself, sorry, I don't have any particular opinion on this. But nuclear power generation, I think we still need. We need safe nuclear power generations anyway. But in order to utilize renewable energy and natural energy, it takes some time to make full use of it. And then during that period of time, surely we can rely on coal or oil or maybe natural gas, but it is not environmental friendly anyway. So we are facing with the natural disasters these days. I'm not saying that this is because of global warming itself, but we have to tackle the issue of global warming as well. So at this moment, I think surely the nuclear power station should be safe, but we need to rely on nuclear power generations for the time being.
I'll follow up with the other two questions in a second, but I'd like to remind our audience that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Hiroshi Inomata, Consul General of Japan in San Francisco, who is discussing the aftermath of the March 2011 earthquake, tsunami, and nuclear crisis in Japan. So looking forward, I guess the next question, the logical extreme question is there any chance of ending nuclear power soon in Japan, and how promising are other energy-efficient technologies?
Yeah. As for the solar power panel energy, I think it was 20 or 25 years ago, I was in charge of grant assistance back in Tokyo, home government, home ministry. We are quite advanced, and then solar panel. But somehow, we didn't continue to develop that solar power panel technologies. We are still front runner, in a way, one of front runners. So we can once invest more on nuclear power, renewable energy, like solar, or we don't have much wind, but wind power. There's a strong possibility we can sort of be aheading the international community. And some of the clean technology, I think Japan is in quite advanced. So that's the reason we did have a discussion with the Silicon Valley people on how we can cooperate and coordinate to cope with in order to make the Japan's rebirth so quickly, so that we can use clean tech, one of a good example of collaboration between Japan and California. And then in that context, I think we will try to be develop as much as possible on the renewable energy field.
Do you think, I mean, the Prime Minister just yesterday, I think I recall, basically said that he didn't see a long-term future for nuclear power in Japan, that he thought that Japan should actually now be examining renewable energy in a much more extensive fashion. How long do you think that will take before Japan retools? I mean, one of the things that I think needs to be remembered is that we're looking at a country which essentially has only very recently been surpassed by China as the world's second largest economy. The economic, the intellectual resources of Japan are remarkable. Do you think these are going to come into play pretty quickly?
Well, what Mr. Khan said, I was not at the press conference, but I read out his transcript. I think what he was saying that we should resume, reduce our nuclear dependency in a planned step-by-step manner. So that he was asked, what is the timetable? His answer seems to be, he declined to comment on the timetable toward a nuclear-free society, saying that it's premature. So that it's step-by-step approach, I think, but I don't read his mind, so that I cannot answer rightly, but it would take some time, or even more than 10 years or so. So I don't think it comes in short period of time.
You're the 10 years
apart. Well, it's my just guess, though, because I'm not expert, but I don't think it's things coming in years' time.
Have you, one of the questions I asked, and it's actually one I should have thought to ask you myself, is have you been back to Japan since the earthquake to see the damage?
No, I haven't. Actually, my mission here is just to stay and to explain what happens in Japan and try to explain present state and also the actual development in Japan, so that I'm not planning to go back to Japan.
Do you know of any studies that have been conducted regarding nuclear, the fallout from the meltdown of the reactors? And have there been any studies both on the ground, literally on the ground in Japan, then also on the offshore, in the ocean nearby, that you're aware of?
I'm sorry, I don't have knowledge of it, but surely they must have been done. And then all the informations out of those checking on examinations whatsoever on the website, so that if you could visit, as I said, the website of Japanese government or maybe through our Consul General's website, you can find the facts. I'm sorry, I'm not well prepared.
No. Another question is regards the U.S.-Japan Security Alliance. Do you see the disaster as having any impact one way or another on the relationship between the U.S. and Japan?
You mean Security Alliance?
The Security Alliance.
Mainly. Well, as I said, it is quite symbolized, called Tomodachi Operation, Operation Tomodachi. And, well, Japanese people are very much grateful to the U.S. forces in Japan and or 7th Fleet from Pacific Command. We debted quite a lot because without the help of U.S. forces, U.S. armed forces, we may not be recover at such speed. So that our acceptance to U.S. forces in Japan is, I think, become greater now.
Greater. What about other countries? One question here is, did Japan or request or allow citizens of other countries to assist in the reconstruction on a short or long-term basis? Is Japan closed to emigration from abroad? It's kind of a different question.
Well, it's a bit different questions, but well then.
As I know North Korea offered it.
We are having some special sanctions to North Korea, but we are accepting nurses and caretakers and caregivers from Indonesia and Philippines based on a bilateral agreement. But as for the tourists, visitors, we welcome all of the visitors coming to Japan. But as for the workers, we do still have a rather strict regulations to let them stay in Japan. But as long as they do have special technical sort of knowledge or special talent, I think the door is open for the foreigners to stay in Japan now.
Another question, how has the worldwide automobile industry been affected, especially Japanese auto parts? I can tell you I've been trying to buy a Prius for the last couple of months. It hasn't been easy, man. So.
Okay. Well, well, I thought it's much more sort of impact on U.S. car manufacturing companies. But somehow, I only heard some U.S. car manufacturing companies had the difficulty in getting special technology or maybe coating technique, which is specialized in a certain small or medium enterprise the factory in affected area. So because that factory didn't start producing that special coating materials, that car manufacturing company has a difficulty to accept or accommodate the request by the consumers. But other than that, supply chain problem we did have, but as for the automobile industries, we don't have any much impact, negative impact this
really?
Time, I think.
So you think it's basically that the worst
is
behind
it? Yeah, I think it is, yes.
Well, I guess one question I have is basically, as you look back at this disaster, what do you think will be the most profound element of change that comes out of it? Do you think that this is going to be one of those events that a century from now people look back at, or do you think it will be and will have said it made a transformation? Or do you see it as essentially one of a string? I mean, Japan has clearly had since for the last, you know, from time immemorial, there have been major disasters. Is this just one of those, or is this going to be transformative?
Well, I think it's a bit early to say anything, I mean, definitive, but In a way, this is really a big event, I think, so transformative, in a way that we need to cope together and we need to work together for the rebirth of Japan. Already we have been hit by the Lehman shock, after Lehman shock and business and economic difficulties. But this incident, or this incident as well, accident, tragic disasters, I think we are now thinking that we have to do something, something new. We have to do, cooperate together and help each other. So that's kind of things. This is a wake-up call to us, I suppose, especially young people. Young people are said to be rather introverted or rather inward-looking, but this time many young volunteers are going to the affected area to help the elderly and help people who have been in difficulty. So that might change the mindsets of young people. That's maybe this is my hope, but I think in that context, I think this is transforming.
That is actually a really interesting question answer, because that leads to a follow-up question is that clearly in Germany it's had an impact. The Germans have essentially said, you know what, I think German government policy was similar to that of Japan. Mm. The impact on the young people is very interesting, because basically what you're saying is that the next generation is much more likely to turn its back on nuclear power, which your generation, our generation, my generation, has seen as the answer to imported coal, oil, what have you. Can you expand a little bit on that? What you think the next generation, what it will do? Will it have an electoral impact? Will it get more involved in nonprofits? I mean, what do you see this moving on?
Well, as for the energy sources, well, young generation needs to think about their future, you see. If it is easy to, as I said, become anti-nuclear, but to be a bit more practical, I think. Realistically, I think we had better not to have any sort of nuclear power stations if we think about this kind of disaster. But practically, we need still nuclear energy, so that young people need to get the practical thinking.
Not is just, there any evidence that they're becoming anti-nuclear?
Well, not in Japan now, no. But if we ask the people in Japan whether you positive or negative, many people saying the negative with easy questions, easy answers, if we ask to do it. But if you think the actual life, we have to cut 15% or 20% of electric consumption. That affects the Japanese economy itself as well, because Japanese companies, factories, they have to think long term. I mean, if there is no electricity coming in, and 5 months later, then they will just change their sort of plan of production itself. That would shrink Japanese economy, so that we had better to think quite ahead, 5 years or 10 years ahead. Then we need we get certain right answer to that.
And I think maybe our final question: yep. What do you say to Americans who fear to visit Japan because of the fallout or other dangers related to the crisis?
Well, sure, I cannot 100% guarantee, but many people visiting Japan now, and then sure, your government is having some restrictions on the area to visit 50 miles of. Nuclear power station in Fukushima. But other than that, I'm sure that if you have a plan to visit, then please do. And I really encourage many people to visit Japan. And then I'm always thankful to the assistance and the many donations and kind words. But even I told Governor Jerry Brown at the time when I had just a chat in Sacramento, I said, the best encouragement at this moment is you to visit Japan. So I really would like to see many people visit Japan.
Well, I will say, you know, maybe this is just a tag-on question, but if you look at the impact of the 1995 quake in Kobe, which was much smaller, I mean, the danger. The danger the impact was traumatic. I mean, much smaller, and the disaster was widespread. One of the things I was consistently amazed at was the limited amount of the damage. When you consider how big this quake was, the impact on Tokyo was remarkably small. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that for both the people in Japan that you should probably take some comfort in is the fact that, okay, I mean, you're looking at a once-in-a-century event, mm-hmm. a quake and a tsunami of the size that hit Sendai and Fukushima. But if you look at the impact on Tokyo, which I don't know what the size of the wave was when it hit Tokyo, but I suspect it was probably in the 8 range, which is an enormous quake. I don't think anybody was killed in Tokyo, was it? I don't think anybody died.
Well, maybe few people died because in some old building, because some bricks fall down and some hit right ahead. So two people, I think, died in Tokyo, but that's only limited two, I think, as far as I know.
And the reason I mention this, it's really fascinating. One of the things that a lot of Americans have, I think, forgotten is during the San Francisco, the Loma Prieta quake in 1989, within, I think it was less than 2 weeks after the Loma Prieta quake, which, as I recall, killed 66 people, there was a quake in then Soviet Armenia, exactly the same size, 7.9. 25,000 people died in that quake.
Wow.
Different geography, obviously, but a big part of it was engineering. And so one of the issues that I think I came away from was that the Japanese really took to heart the engineering lessons of the Kobe mm-hmm. quake.
True.
And that what you see, I mean, as disastrous as this quake was, with the exception of the reactors, which were all in the 1960s design, and that's a huge, huge, I think it's a huge, huge caveat. But basic architectural design prevented a much worse catastrophe. I mean, I recognize that the death of nearly 30,000 people is a disaster of epic proportions. But, you know, it's not what it could have been. It mm-hmm. could have been infinitely worse.
Right.
So do you have any final comments for the audience, our radio audience, our internet
yes.
audience?
Surely. I repeatedly mentioned that we are very much pleased to share our experience and then the lessons we have learned, but still we are learning with people in all over the world, especially California, as I said, hit quite a large-scale earthquake in the past. So that we would like to cope with the government or private people and business people, and then sharing the information and then sharing the idea how to rebuild a society, strong society, resilient to the natural disaster. So I really would like to work hard on this matter, and I'm really pleased to working with you on this matter as well. Thank you.
So I'd like to thank Hiroshi Inomata, Consul General of Japan in San Francisco, for his remarks. And we'd also like to thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. Today's program has been held in association with the Commonwealth Club's Asia-Pacific Forum. I'm Dr. Bruce Pickering, Executive Director of the Asia Society Northern California Center. And now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you're in the know, is adjourned.